Welcome to the Questions for Christians TV show. In this series, I ask Christians that are in leadership about their views on important and interesting topics in philosophy and theology. The show has 5 10-minute sections. The first one is, how should we interpret the Adam and Eve story in light of modern science? The second one is, how should we interpret the Noah's Ark story in light of modern science? The third one is morality grounded in God, or what is the grounding for morality if you don't believe in God? And the fourth one is, can one feel the presence of God? Is that evidence for the existence of God? The fifth one is, why is there something rather than nothing? It's kind of an age-old question. How do you explain the origins of the world? And we'll have some time for a wrap-up summary. My name is Bernie Dehler. I was an evangelical born-again Christian for over 25 years. I have a bachelor's degree in electronics engineering technology and have been working in the computer industry since 1984. In 2007, I earned a master's in ministry degree from Luther Ice Seminary. It's a Baptist seminary. And in 2009, I left the faith and I became an atheist. I also wrote a booklet called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology to help share my ideas. Today, my guest is Matt Slick, and Matt heads up an apologetics organization that's defending the Christian faith. So, welcome to the show, Matt.
Thank you.
And I'd like to give you a minute to, can you explain about what you do to people who have never heard your name before? Can you give some background about who you are and what you do?
Yeah. 20 years ago, I started a website just in response to some of the stuff on the early stages of the internet, responding to some of the, I thought, less than capable or less than accurate comments about Christianity and other things. I started a website, and it just exploded, basically. People all over started asking me questions, and now the site gets roughly 16 million visitors a year. So, you know, it's just busy. And I defend the Christian faith and attack other systems of thought that don't comport with Christianity. That's what I do.
You take captive every thought that sets itself up against Christ?
That's right, 2 Corinthians 10:5, that's correct.
Yeah, one of my favorite verses when I was a Christian.
Yeah.
So have you written any books?
Yeah, The Influence, it's a novel aimed at unbelievers that teaches Christian theology, and it probably would be rated R if it were made into a movie. People say it make a great movie. There's no cussing, no nudity, but it's got demons, angels fighting, things like that. And I've written a book called Right Answers for Wrong Beliefs. That's about 15 years old. And I've also got a book, for real, the title is actually, this is dead serious, this is the title, How to Woo and Win Women by Being an Obnoxious Jerk. And so I have a good sense of humor and write humor, poetry, short stories, and some other stuff. And I've got numerous manuals I've written, and written thousands upon thousands and thousands of pages of stuff on karma.
So your manuals, those are manuals for doing apologetics?
Yeah, apologetics, school of theology, apologetics, critical thinking. I've got manuals on Mormonism, Roman Catholicism, Calvinism. I'm a Calvinist. Basic Christian doctrine, things like that.
Okay.
All kinds of stuff.
And are those at your website?
Yeah, in fact, you know, it's a little embarrassing here. I'm not exactly sure how you find them on the website. I just write so much. Others take care of things. But it's there. If you want to find them, you can...
Okay, and I think I noticed online you have a Master's in Divinity degree?
Right, from Westminster Theological Seminary, Master's of Divinity, 1991.
Okay, so you should be qualified to know something about theology, it sounds like.
Yeah, right. I know my theology pretty well. Yeah.
I got a Master's in Ministry degree, but the Master's in Divinity is more credits, and your school is more reputable than the school I actually went to, so I could appreciate the training you went through.
Yeah, it was at the time, it was the fifth most difficult graduate school in the country. So it was tough. I'll admit it was quite difficult.
But yeah, well, okay. That may come into play later in our discussion too. It's anyway. So the first topic then, I'm trying to ballpark for 10 minutes. This is a discussion about Adam and Eve. As I understand it. You know, there's three basic camps, I think, about how do you interpret the Adam and Eve story. And the reason why I have this topic is because when I was a Christian, I was kind of frustrated that it was difficult to talk about this in church, I think, because it's divisive. And I think the three general camps are, there's a young earth, well, actually, the young earth creationists and old earth creationists agree that Adam was built from scratch by a miracle. And then the next step up would be, if the way I put it, if you accept more modern science, because would be evolutionary creationism, which basically says that humans evolved from other animals and this was a God-designed process. And I would take that further and just say there's no God required. So what is your take on the Adam and Eve story? How would you say to interpret that?
God created Adam out of dust of the ground, breathed into him life, created Eve out of him, and they were our first parents so long ago. That's what I believe.
You know, I guess one question I have is that the position from your school that your school taught? Because, I mean, just to tell you, I'm kind of perplexed because I would have thought that your school would probably be a lot more open to evolution.
No, not at all. Westminster Theological Seminary is very orthodox, and it's not what a school or a denomination would teach. I don't give a flying rip what they say. I care what the Word of God says. That's what the Word of God says. That's what the Bible says. That's what it is.
Well, the evolutionary creationist will say it's not a matter of what the Bible says literally, it's how you interpret it. I mean, because you wouldn't expect them to know modern science.
Well, then what I would say is, when people start saying to me, well, this is how I interpret it, what I then say is, oh, thank you for calling me handsome, I appreciate that. Then they'll say, what are you talking about? Oh, yeah, I'm also intelligent. Oh, yeah, thank you very much. And they don't know what I'm doing. I said, well, if it's just a matter of interpretation, well, then I can interpret whatever you say to mean whatever I want it to say.
Well, I guess off the top of my head, you know, the reason why I accepted evolution is because there's two main arguments. One is, and they're both with DNA, one is the fused human chromosome number 2, and the other one is pseudogenes. Are you familiar with those arguments?
No.
So it sounds like you aren't familiar with the evidence for evolution then.
I'm familiar with a lot of evidence for evolution. I'm not familiar with those two particular things. So if you were to conclude that if I don't know two particular things, that doesn't mean I haven't studied evolution. That would be a fallacious conclusion.
Okay, well, these are major arguments. For example, there's one Christian, I told you before we talked personally, there's this group called ASA, American Scientific Affiliation.
Mm-hmm.
They don't technically adhere to any position, but they had a presentation from an evangelical scientist, and he basically gave a presentation on the evidence for evolution, and basically pseudogenes is a good argument. And
I'll have to study up on pseudogenes.
And basically he was saying, you know, he was anti-evolution until he was studying for his PhD, and when he saw this paper about the pseudogene study, basically the pseudogene is that there's, like, if you look at the class of mammals, we have all these genes that they can see that they are busted, and if we have busted genes, and you can see how they progressively break according to descent. So it just seems like basically this is like footsteps in the DNA. It's kind of like a DNA archaeology kind of.
Could it be that they were designed and a common design element would require common features? Is that possible?
No, because they're broken. And so basically.
Oh, like, you mean the genetic line where they were broken is passed down?
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Is it passed down across phyla?
It's actually, if you just looked at the mammals only, for example, there's a common ancestor between humans and chimps, and that common ancestor, and then let's say us and the chimps, we share broken pseudogenes, and if you go up one level, I'm not sure if I have my chart here, but if you go up one level, there's a common ancestor, I think, with gorillas, and then there's more broken genes, and then the higher you go up, every level you see these broken genes. And they go according to the same path of descent.
Well, I'd have to study it. So I do know this. I wanted to be a marine biologist, and so I enjoy science. But I do know that people have a way of interpreting things that suits their position. You know, that's what most everybody does. And if I'm not familiar with something, I don't like to comment about it. I say, well, let me study it.
Mm-hmm.
Pseudogenes. I can do that. No problem.
Yeah, the other thing is fused human chromosome number 2. Basically, that argument there is that if you look at the for example, or the chimps, if there are cousins, they and the gorillas, you can see they have two separate chromosomes, and then we have one less set of chromosomes than they do. And the reason why is because they merged in the end. And like at the ends of chromosomes, they have what they call telomeres. And we can see that, you don't need the telomeres in the middle, so they're vestigial. And there's also centromeres in the middle. And since you now have two centromeres, one of those is vestigial. So we can see that the human fuse number two chromosome is actually a fusion event, which would mean that humans were not made from scratch, but basically it looks like those are again footprints from descent. And this was actually, Ken Miller has a YouTube video going over this because he said this was presented in the Dover case, for trying to get intelligent design in the schools. And he was saying the opposite side had no rebuttal on this. They just didn't say anything because there was nothing they could say on this.
Well, I don't know if that's accurate. Let me tell you, I've done enough research over the years where, let's just say, I don't necessarily trust the opposing side. A lot of lies have been perpetrated. A lot of misinformation has been perpetrated. And it's happened within Christianity as well. So what I like to do is check the facts, check them out for myself, see what is going on, and do my own assessment instead of just saying, well, someone said this and they didn't have an answer. I don't find that to be the case ever, that they don't have an answer. They just sit there in silence. They can't say anything. No, they may have had a response, and it wasn't accepted, and people say, see, they didn't have an answer. So it's a lot of it is how you interpret what happens. Me, I like to do my research, so I study everything. My library is extensive, and I'm trying to teach myself the basics of genetics. Every now and then, I'll read some stuff on genetics and nucleotide bond pairs and permutability and codons and all kinds of stuff. I want to learn what that is because I want to learn how it relates to information theory. So I got to study information theory while I'm answering 4,000 emails, and things like this. So, I'll look up pseudogenes and see what I can find.
I'll try to send you the link from from Dennis Venema because that's exactly what his presentation was. It was going over all the basics for the layman. And so he basically talks about the basics of DNA code, and he shows how it changes across different organisms. So
no problem. Yeah, send it to me. I'm not afraid of facts. Doesn't bother me at all. Do some research. See if there's alternate explanations of things. And that's the thing is what's the presupposition someone comes to the evidence with? Because evidence is a concept, and concepts in the state of evidence deal with the goal at hand. And something becomes supportive evidence if it fits the goal that is presupposed. Mm-hmm. So there's a philosophy of how things are analyzed that I want to see. How are they thinking these things through? Are they being logical about what they're assuming? And do their assumptions govern their interpretations?
Yeah, and when I was a Christian, if you do come to accept evolution, I think it ripples through all of your apologetics.
But I do believe in evolution.
You don't believe that humans descended from other animals?
That's correct.
And so that's basically evolution as how it's taught in every public university.
Oh, but evolution is change of allele frequency over time. Basically, it's an adaptation. Mm-hmm. You can have minor speciation occurring within a genetic pool that does not necessitate phyla change.
Right. But so you're talking about microevolution.
Sure.
Yeah,
which
but
is
macro
basically reduction of the gene pool.
Okay, but
I have no problem with that.
Right. Yeah. So the problem is, if you go further and accept macroevolution, this is what's taught as evolution in every university, every public university. Like in Oregon, we have two of them, or at least three of them. I think we have Oregon State University, Oregon, Portland State, and every single state university teaches evolution as modern science.
Yeah, I know they do, but I don't go with argumentum ad populum. A majority of the people do it, so therefore it's true. Come on. I'm a little more sophisticated than that. Just because you sit and a bunch of people believe something, it doesn't mean it's so. Majority of people believe the Earth was flat 1,000 years ago. It doesn't mean it's correct.
Well, now, this is an interesting thing we can talk about. I would say that the argument ad populum, basically, it's a bandwagon argument that... Basically, you're saying that it's a fallacy because a lot of people believe in it. Doesn't mean it's true, right?
Yeah, what I'm saying is, if a bunch of people tell me that the scientists 90% believe it, I say, well, that's nice. So what? That means 98% believe it. Does it mean it's true? Doesn't mean it's true. It means that a bunch of people think it's true. Mm-hmm. But we have seen through history that a majority of people can believe something. It doesn't mean it's true. Mm-hmm. That's why I like to study.
Yeah, I think one thing a little bit different there is on scientific consensus, though. When you talk about what the experts believe,
even the experts have a way of padding their information, mm-hmm. because there is a lot of experts that have to tote the status quo. Otherwise, they'll lose their positions. We know that's true. There's plenty of cases that's the case. It's been documented. But it doesn't mean that everybody's wrong. It doesn't mean that they are wrong either. It's just, this is part of the information pool that we've got to look at.
You're right.
Like I said, I like to study it for myself.
Yeah, well, the other part of the dialogue on that, though, is one reason why they might be in jeopardy of their job is because they'd be accused of having pseudoscience. You know, for example, if they don't believe in evolution and they're teaching biology, there's an argument that they're teaching pseudoscience. That's why they don't deserve to have a job in biology.
Yeah, well, maybe they're not teaching pseudoscience, and maybe the presupposition is that if you disagree with the status quo, that you're teaching pseudoscience is a problem. Mm-hmm. And besides that, science is a philosophy. It's an approach. It's a belief system.
Well, I don't think so with that. That's another argument I guess we could have.
Oh, it's very quickly. I can show you very quickly.
Okay.
It presupposes the validity of the laws of logic, but cannot prove them. Science is nothing more than observation in the physical realm, and out of the physical realm, developing a hypothesis, which is an untested idea. This is basically what science is, developing a set of experiments to test the hypothesis, and through testing and repetition, the hypothesis is modified, usually modified, and becomes a theory once it's been tested. The theory is just a theory. It is not considered necessarily to be absolute fact. So in the issue of philosophy, you presuppose the validity of the laws of logic upon which your thinking must be built, and you presuppose that the universe behaves in a consistent way, even though you can't prove that it does. There are presuppositions that are philosophically based, that are faith-based, science must work upon in order to attack the physical realm. It's only within the Christian worldview can we account for the uniformity of nature. You can't account for it from a scientific methodology.
I would like to address this, but it seems like we're going way off topic because we were talking about Adam and Eve, and then let me just say a little something about that. You said it's faith-based, but don't we both agree that there's nothing? I mean, are you saying we both have the same faith?
Excuse me, the assumptions of science that science is built upon is based on belief, the uniformity of nature.
But do you and I share that belief?
We do, but I can justify why it's the case. You can't as an atheist.
I can justify it, I think.
Nope.
Based on success.
Oh, but that's called pragmatism, or it's just called observation. You should read Hume on that. He destroyed it. Just because it's worked 10 times out of 10 times doesn't mean it'll work 11 times out of 11.
Yeah.
It's an assumption. It's called the inductive principle, the problem of induction. You should know that, I hope, that it's not what you want to base fact on. Well, the best you got is educated guesses, and it works for the most part. It works. But the whole point I'm trying to make is the science of philosophy, the scientific method is based upon assumptions that the science itself can't validate.
Okay, so we're going to do some talk later on, some bonus material. I'll put this down here as a scientific method. We can talk more about that.
Sure.
Okay, so is there, on Adam and Eve, is there any closing thoughts you want to put on this?
Well, I would say through Adam, sin entered the world. Through Jesus, he paid for the sins of the world. That you need to repent of your apostasy and come to faith in Christ. Okay.
What if it, and do you think you would still believe that if you came to accept evolution as a Christian, do you think you'd still say that same statement?
We already went over this. I believe in evolution, but you're
equivocating. No, if you believed in macroevolution.
No, I don't believe in macroevolution.
No.
And I've studied it, and I don't believe it works.
No, I'm saying though, if you did study it and came to accept macroevolution, would you still make that same statement about Jesus?
Well, I don't know. But you see, it's like saying, if you jump high enough, can you touch the moon? Well, the answer is yes. Otherwise, you haven't jumped high enough. If I believe in macroevolution, what would that entail? To what extent would I believe in it? So there are certain necessities that would logically follow out of that, wouldn't there be?
Okay, I don't think I can jump. I don't think anybody can jump high enough to get to the moon.
It's not an issue of ability. It's if you jumped high enough, could you touch the moon? Logically, the answer is yes. Otherwise, you've not jumped high enough.
I don't think it's humanly possible.
I didn't say, is it humanly possible? It's an issue of logic, and I often raise that up with people to try and see what their critical thinking level is, to see if they understand the issues designed inside of a statement.
Well, jumping means something. I mean, if you said shot out of a cannon, that'd be a different story, but jumping is specific.
If I were to hit a nail with a hammer enough times, would the head be driven down into the wood, flush with the wood?
Sure.
Yeah. That's a logical necessity.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you did it enough times, if I didn't do it enough times, it wouldn't have happened.
Mm-hmm.
If you jump high enough, then you touch the moon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Otherwise,
it's not high enough. It's a simple logic issue.
Okay.
Okay.
So the next topic then is Adam and Eve. What is your position on that? I'm not Adam and Eve. It's Noah's Ark.
I have no problem with Noah's Ark. Did you know that something like 80 or 90% of the cultures around the world have a flood story?
No, wait a second, though. When you say you have no problem with it, we have to say, what is your definition of it? Because there's different Christian definitions of what that is, you know.
Yeah, the biblical account of Adam and Eve in Genesis 6 and following, I have no Adam and Eve, of Noah's Ark, I have no problem with that. The animals entering in the Ark, I have no problem with that at all.
Yeah, but see, still that's not defined because you have the old Earth creationists who believe in a local flood, and the young Earth creationists say there was a global flood.
So?
So there's a huge difference there because the global flood...
Well, who are you talking with? Them?
Well, that's what I'm trying to say, that you're not clearly defining it yet. So which one are you? Do you believe there's a worldwide flood or a local flood?
I suspect that there was a worldwide flood.
Well, off the top of my mind, I mean, I've heard you talk in debates before about the
transcendental argument. Yeah.
Transcendental God, a God that transcends
space and time.
Space and time, and is there a way to test that? And I think this is like one of those claims about God where, if there was a worldwide flood, it would leave a mark. And it seems to me.
You mean like sedimentary layers everywhere?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Oh, which is what we find. Okay.
No, we don't find.
Yes, we do.
We don't see the fossil record.
Mm-hmm. You find sedimentary layers with marine fossils all over the world, even on mountaintops.
Mm-hmm. And why do modern geologists say that there's fossils on top of mountains, marine fossils?
Because the mountains are underwater?
Yes, and they moved up by tectonic plate action.
Yeah, no problem, see? And I'm glad you believe the biblical model. That's good.
And what kind of fossils are they? Are they whale fossils up there? Are they shark fossils?
They're usually small invertebrates to small shelled.
They're things that are appropriate for being, according to, millions of years old. In other words, there are not shark fossils up there. There are not whale fossils. There are not any kind of, they're all things that would be consistent with a very old Earth and there was tectonic plate action moving it up there.
Or let's just take a whale body. And during the flood, let's say a whale dies, and the bacteria in it causes it to bloat, so the sharks out there are going to eat it, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay, so you'd have a dissemination of the carcass around an area. So how many of those would you expect to be fossilized? I mean, that's a subjective question.
Mm-hmm.
Not too many.
Yes.
However, if you would expect or see that small invertebrates and shell-based creatures, which are all over and hard-shelled the whole bit, then they're going to fall down through, not through predation. They're not going to be absorbed in predation or scavenging. They're just going to fall down to the bottom, and that's what you'd expect in a flood, wouldn't you?
Well, I agree with you. Number one, I mean, kind of in general, fossilization is a very rare event. But they do find whale fossils. In fact, that's one of the evidences that some people give for evolution is that they said, well, if evolution is true, which means that the whales are mammals and they actually migrated from the land, they were once land animals, we should probably find this certain kind of animal in this certain kind of area. And they've actually looked and found some of these animals. I can't remember which one. I think it was in Turkey or something. They actually found what they're looking for, but you're not going to find these on a mountaintop.
Well, that's science. They found what they're looking for?
Yeah, because there was a prediction that, you know, we find these kind of fossils and we believe that this kind of land animal became like hippos are supposed to be pretty closely related to whales. I mean, like they give birth underwater and they spend a lot of time in water and things like that. But I can't remember the exact fossil sequence, but they made a prediction and they looked for it and they actually found some intermediaries
How do
according
they
to the
know they're
prediction.
intermediaries?
Well, I can't remember if it was exactly on this one. It might be where you can see the blowhole progressing from the nostril to the top of the head. You
Okay,
can
well,
see a
here's a question.
progression.
How do you know it's an intermediary? Now, here's the question. I'm serious. It's a serious question. How do you know? Well, the scientists are going to say to me, because it looks like it.
Well, it's
That's
like I said,
science?
like I said, it's a progression of the blowhole. There's another one. There's a progression of the inner ear. There are some parts that they look at the ear.
Okay, you're not hearing me. It's called homology. Because it looks like it, therefore it is. That's it. That's a science. That is science. You're telling me, well, it looks like it. They predict it. I could predict the same thing with intelligent design. And so you would expect to see that if God were to create various creatures at various times, that they would have a progression of the location of the blowhole in proportion to their formation. I could say the same thing and make a prediction and say you would expect this, you'd expect this, you'd expect that. And what? Because it looks like it? If I say, well, it looks like it, so that's how come I know? You say, well, that doesn't work. Then
Wait a
why would you
second.
use it?
Wait a
Because it looks
second.
like it.
Wait a second. You know what? I prepared for an evolution debate one time on whale fossils, you know, and I actually contacted this one professor who's kind of famous on whale fossils, and I had this certain theory that I had, and I ran it past him, and I said, "What do you think about this for an argument for evolution?" And his response was, "Well, you know, as far as he says, as far as I'm concerned, speaking for himself, it's like whales are mammals, duh." And it's like, think about it. They're mammals on the ground, they're land animals, and now they're in the ocean. If you see a shark and you see a killer whale, they both look like fish, but they're not. There's one's a mammal and one's a fish.
Yeah.
Why would God? So the ID theory, your intelligent design theory, your creationist theory is like, there was no sharks at all. Boom, God made a bunch of sharks. There was no whales at all. Boom, God made a bunch of whales.
Yeah.
Why would he make whales as mammals, sharks as fish, and then it looks like there's a progression from whale, you know, from land animal to whale. Why would he, unless he's trying to mislead people, it doesn't make sense that God would make a progression there.
You're assuming there's a progression to begin with, and you're basing it off what's called homology. It
Well,
simply looks like it. That's not scientific to say it looks like it, and that's how come we know. I forgot what the other term is, but there's a convergent evolutionary theory where you can have something that resembles another species and they have no convergence, even within the evolutionary theory. And if you didn't know, you'd say, well, they're similar because they look like it. And if you studied Eohippus, you'll know that the fossilized record has been altered a little bit and they're out of sequence. And yet, from small to big, which is they look like it, and that's how they're presented in books, but there's a fossilized, there's a problem in the dating and the arrangement of the fossil because in some sedimentary areas, some strata, they don't fit the normal pattern. But that's not brought up.
it's not brought up.
No. There's all kinds of problems. Look, for example, have you ever studied the woodpecker? Seriously, the woodpecker. You ever studied the woodpecker?
No.
Did you know its tongue goes out of its mouth, down by through its jaw, down by its neck, next to its vertebra, down behind its skull? There's a groove in the skull between the skull and the scalp. It goes up the scalp, down the forehead, down between the eyes, down through a nostril and out the mouth. Not to mention the musculature that has to work in the neck, and there's a certain arc problem. But how do you think something like that evolves? Do you think it helps survivability when a tongue is stuck in the back of your neck?
Well, it helps survivability if they can get the what are they doing? Pecking on wood to get some
That's what they
insects
do,
out
and the
of.
only way that can work is if the whole thing works together. See, that's best understood in intelligent design. It's design because you can't have, I mean, I could see, mom and dad woodpecker, hey, look, You know, Junior here's got his tongue stuck in the back of his head. Well, don't worry about it, Martha. It'll be fine. Just give him a couple million years.
Well, the other thing about the whales is, as far as being mammals, since the year 2000, they've started getting all this genome sequencing, and they've been doing all these comparisons, and so there's a lot of interesting code. You can look at the actual code and see things, too.
Cladistics, yes.
But I guess I think I'm just kind of struck, too, by that comment about they're mammals, duh. You know, it's
mammals. They're mammals, so what? Why wouldn't God create mammals in the ocean? Do you know what the percentage is of species that are now extinct on the Earth?
Yeah. There's like 99% are extinct.
Yeah, I thought it was 98, but yeah. Okay, 98, 99% are extinct. Well, if God created them, I don't know if you've ever studied, seriously, I don't know if you've ever studied the problem of, we're not talking about abiogenesis, but it relates. The problem of abiogenesis and the genes, the nucleotide bond pair sequence that must be in place, and permutability and the mathematical probability about all this stuff, which is really interesting, it really is a problem for abiogenesis. It's impossible. It can't happen by chance. It's impossible. There's also this thing that when
I think it's impossible to calculate the odds of it.
No, it's not.
I think it is.
No, it's not.
I can give you a simple example.
I can give you an example and show you how it works.
Okay. And then I'll give you an example.
Okay, you know what DNA is, deoxyribonucleic acid, right?
Right.
And it has nucleotide bond pairs. You know what those are, right?
A, T, C, and G you're talking about?
Yeah, adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, A, T, and G, C.
Mm-hmm.
So you have A, T, and T, A, and G, C, and C, G. That's all you've got is four different options. So when you have, it's called permutation. If you have two things, it's called factoring. How many different ways can they be arranged? Two times one. If you have three things, it's three times two times one. Four things, it's four times three times two times one. Well, when you have this, when you have the first rung, the first nucleotide bond pair has one of four possibilities. The next one has one in four. The next one has one in four. The next one has one in four.
Mm-hmm.
So you go one quarter or 0.25 times 0.25 times 0.25 times 0.25. And you go on. Now, the virus, I'm skipping some stuff, but the virus is the simplest life form. Some debate if it's alive, but whatever. 200,000 nucleotide bond pairs in the base genetic sequence. The base. It's not exact right numbers, but this is just for illustration purposes. So it's 0.25 times 200,000.
Well, you're making a very simple mistake, I can tell you.
What's the mistake?
You have this major assumption that's totally wrong, is that there's a certain target you're trying to hit. There is no target code.
Ah, but here's the thing. In order for the code to work, there has to be a reader. Just because there's a random formation of nucleotide bond pairs doesn't mean it's information. Life is information. And there has to be a reader. If I send you a letter with the word C-A-T, cat, the only way that you would get that is if you were to read it and understand it. That's how information is. But the physical formation of CAT is not itself not information unless there's a sender and a receiver.
But what does that have to do with the numbers?
Information.
See, what happened?
The DNA molecule has to have a receiver, has to have something that is acted upon mm-hmm. by it to perform something.
Right. So
you can't have any which way.
Well, okay, there's a ribosome that takes three letters, and it converts that to an uh-huh. amino acid.
Where did it get the information to do that, the instruction to do that?
Okay, that's a different question, but I'm just talking about your mathematics.
But it's part of the process.
I'm just talking about your mathematics, though.
Well, the mathematics is that this is a sequence of any particular virus of, say, 200,000 nucleotide bond pairs.
Yeah, but let me tell you something, though, too, about every three letters will give you an amino acid, and every amino acid has more than one code. So, for example, there's some where I can't remember the exacts, but you can have like ATT or ATG, and it doesn't matter. It's the same exact amino acid. So there's no exact code you have to hit as a target.
I didn't say there was.
Yeah. You did because you said
no.
You made it sound like the first letter
no.
has to be ATC or G,
no.
and you have a 25% chance on the first one.
No, I said you have one in four chance of any particular one being there. That's all. That's all it is. When you have a sequence of 200,000, there's a certain mathematical relationship. In this case, it would be 0.25 to 200,000 power. I mean, that's the odds of that. It doesn't mean that it's impossible. It just means that's the mathematical number.
Well, see, actually, there's the opposite argument that if you look at like a certain code for a protein and you see all these ATCGs and everything, and if you say, look, here's one way of coding this, how many different ways could I code this? There's an astronomical different ways you could code it if you wanted
yes.
to. And that's actually one of the arguments for evolution, because when you actually look at the code, you can see in human, you can see in organisms where sometimes they just change by one bit, and it doesn't change the amino acid at all. It's just the underlying code.
Right.
And then sometimes there's another bit changes, and then you get a different amino acid, but then you still have the same protein.
Yeah, except that the information has to be there in order for it to be altered. Plus, the mm-hmm. folds in the protein molecules are also informational. Even the location of the folds are.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's a thing called the universal probability bound, and what that means is this. That is a mathematical maximum number of potential occurrences in the entire universe. If the universe were 18 billion years old, which it isn't, but 18 billion, and you were to calculate how many seconds there are in 18 billion years, how many particles there are, roughly 10 to the 80th, and the Planck's constant, 10 to the 40th, is the maximum number of times that a particle can change its state potentially. You have the number of particles, which is 10 to the 80th, times 40, times 18 billion years, which happens to be 10 to the 18th seconds, you get roughly 136, or 10 to the 136 power, which is the maximum number of potential occurrences in the universe. If 18 billion years, every single particle in the entire universe were changing its state 10 to the 40th times per second, you get 10 to the 136th power. When you get 0.25 times 200 to the 200,000th power, it's so far beyond that, it's incomprehensibly far beyond it. And yet people will say, yeah, life formed by chance. Not only do you have to have the molecule and the atoms, the molecule, the nucleotide bond pairs, in whatever order they're going to be, they can't just be in any. They have to have a certain sequence because they have to be read by something else that reads them in order for it to work.
Well, let me give you a simple illustration to why I think that's a bogus calculation.
Okay.
If I said, for example, here's a bunch of cards I have. I show you my cards. And I say, what are the odds of me pulling out an ace of hearts? And I pull out an ace of hearts. What do you think the odds are?
It's 52, it's 110, 104, 208, 1 in 208, right?
Well, some people might say there's 52 cards.
Sorry, I messed it up. Yeah. 1 in 52, sorry.
Yeah, so some people might say 1 in 52. But see, right there, you assumed it was a standard deck. What if if I removed the ace of hearts, or if I just have all black cards, the probability would have been 0. Or if I had a deck that was just all aces of hearts, the probability would have been 100%. So you don't know unless you know the basics. Now, when it comes to how did life originate, nobody knows. So this is like saying, here's a bunch of cards. We don't know what's in there. What are the odds? And that's exactly what you did, is you said...
No, it's not.
You can't calculate the odds of an unknown process. That's the bottom line.
I didn't. I just said the odds of an existing molecule.
That's assuming that you know how it came to form.
I did not. I said that's the odds of an existing molecule.
Based on what?
Based on math. If there's 200,000 parts and there's 1 in 4 potential for each part, well, then it's 1 in 4 times to the 200,000th power. That's just mathematics.
That's just mathematics as far as the number of calculations. Or the
permutability.
The number of...
possible combinations of all the things, but they had to be in a certain sequence in order for life to occur, because it has to be in harmony with the reader.
But the sequence doesn't have to be exact, though. That's one thing I was trying to tell you also.
I know it doesn't have to be exact.
Because
it has to be sufficient.
For example, every amino acid has, some of them have like 4 or 5 or 6 different alternate codes. So you can change one of those nucleotides, and it has absolutely no, there's no such thing as like a perfect code for a certain amino acid.
Right, because there's enough redundancy in them, even in the folds, that there's it takes care of that.
Good.
Have you ever read the article or read it's called the Mathematical Challenges to the Neo-Darwinian Theory of Evolution?
Well,
I would check it out.
I actually talked to William Dempsey about this in person, because he was at this conference one time, and I basically told him my card example, and I don't think he really had a response for it.
Well, I've had lunch with William Dempsey. I've talked to him on the phone before. And the guy has, I don't know what his degree is in mathematics, but it's upper level. He's a Christian, Presbyterian, elder. Maybe he was being polite with you. And I'm not trying to insult you in any way, but maybe he was just saying, I'll just let that go.
Well, you know, another brilliant guy who's a Christian evangelical is Francis Collins, and he fully accepts that humans evolved from other animals. And
he's a heretic.
Well, he would say the other people are scientifically naive, So
they can say it, but I'm just telling what the Bible says. He's a heretic.
Well, he would say
outside the camp of orthodoxy within scriptural revelation.
So when you say he's a heretic, you're saying he's interpreting the Bible wrong, and he's saying you're interpreting the Bible wrong. You're trying to make it, teach science, which it's not intended to do. So
the Bible is not a scientific book, but it doesn't contradict science either.
Okay. You want to summarize something? Summarize this, and we'll move on to the next one.
Oh no, I think we've gone. Let's just move on to the next one. We kind of really digressed in this, which is kind of fun.
Yeah, and I think we're going over time here.
That's all right.
So, a lot. So we'll probably have to shorten this one up here. This is your favorite topic. Is morality grounded in God? The reason why I chose this topic to talk to people about is because I participate in a lot of debates, Christian atheist debates, and it hasn't happened too much with me, but it comes up. I hear frequently that the Christian will say that the atheists borrow from the Christian
worldview,
which I don't think so at all. I don't think you need God for morality. So I can tell you what my basis is if that's what you want to hear.
Let me help you out.
Okay.
No, you don't need God for morality.
Or for a basis.
What?
Or for a basis in morality.
No, you don't need God for a basis in morality.
Or for a grounding in morality.
Now you know what you're doing here. I would say that we need God for objective moral standards. Objective morality is different than just morals.
I got to tell you, one of the confusing things there is that I thought William Lane Craig was saying that morals are objective, but then I actually heard him say, I'm not sure if it was on a YouTube video or maybe it was in writing, but it sounded like he was starting to say that morals can be relative or subjective, but it's just that when you subjectively analyze them, there's an objective
way
to analyze them. He says basically there's an objective way to analyze them subjectively. So, I mean, that's really getting confusing.
Well, I'll just see what he exactly said. But, see, I have an article on my website, carm.org. I have a website. And the article is, can atheists be ethical? Yes, they can. I mean, of course atheists can be ethical. Of course they can have a moral system. Of course they, and they do. They have to. They can't function in society without one. The question isn't that. The question is, do they have any objective moral standards by which they can say something is right or is wrong?
Well, I can say I have a moral standard where I can say things are right or wrong, but I don't need objective morals.
No. Okay, let's pick. Do you believe that statements are either true or false?
Yeah.
Okay, here's a statement. It is always wrong for anyone to torture babies to death merely for their personal pleasure. Is that statement true or is the statement not true?
I would say it's true, but can I say something about that?
Sure.
I think what you're doing when you ask that question is you are picking the better word instead of objective is obvious. You're picking like extremes and say, is this an extreme example? It's kind of like it's obvious, not so much absolute or objective. It's obvious.
Well, what's obvious to you is not obvious to everybody else.
But what I meant is you purposely pick something that's way out on the extreme instead of something that's vague, where ethics really comes into play, trying to figure out the vague things or the controversial things.
We need absolutes in order to address the vague things first. You don't start with what's vague. You start with truths.
Do you want me to tell you what my basis? Do you want me to tell you what my basis is for morality?
Now we're going to get to that.
Okay.
You see, the thing is, can say as an atheist, it's always wrong for everyone to do ABC, whatever it is. It's always wrong for everyone. As an atheist, you can't ground that in your atheism as being valid.
I think
You can believe it is. You can say, in my opinion, it's wrong for everybody. But what you're doing is you're saying, I believe there's a moral absolute everyone ought to subject themselves to.
No, I don't think there's a moral absolute, but I think I can ground it.
You said it was a true statement.
Yes, I do.
It's always wrong for everyone. Then you believe there's a moral obligation to everyone that they should follow, because you believe it's wrong for everybody.
Right. Based on my principles, right.
But you see, you're saying there is a universal truth.
A universal truth?
Yes, it's always wrong for everyone to do ABC, whatever it is. You believe that's the case.
How can you
justify that in your atheism?
Can I tell you how I justify it and then see how you go with that? So from my studies, I have, the way I see it is morality is all about behavior, good and behavior is, the question is, what is good and bad behavior? And good behavior leads to flourishing and bad behavior leads to pain for a community or whatever. So then the question is, what principles can we do to try to figure out what's good and bad behavior? And I came up with three pillars that I think are good for sorting out ethical problems, and this is my own study. One of them is consequentialism, one is reciprocity, and the other one is individual free rights. And some moral questions play on two or three of those, and that's why they're very tough to figure out. But the example you gave is very obvious. I mean, it's like consequentialism is an obvious one there, because you don't want a society that's going to be doing that kind of behavior. And I don't want my kids subjected to that behavior. So, I mean, that's why I'm saying it's an obvious answer on that. I'm not saying my answer is based on some kind of objective reasons. I'm saying it's based on my principles. And the reason why I have those principles is because I see how they work to making a good society. And if somebody else gives me different principles, and I think those are good, I'll adopt those and maybe switch out mine or enhance them.
Yeah, you're like a walking example of begging the question.
Okay. What's the question? What am I begging?
Okay. You say it's based on my principles because I see how they work making a good society. You see how something works, makes a good society. You're assuming that the things that work are themselves the goals. You have a standard that is really arbitrary. It's based on your personal opinion. You'll say, this works in society, that's why it's good. Well, why is it good? Because it works in society. Well, what works in society? That which is good. Well, what's good? That which works in society. It's circular.
No, I don't agree with that.
You
when you say what's good for society, I said it leads to flourishing.
But why is flourishing good?
Okay, so that's a different question. The reason
but
why
it's part of it's part of it.
The
why
reason
is it
why is because people prefer to live in pleasure and they want to avoid pain.
Why it's good, because of what people want?
Sure.
Oh, so if I want to rob you, is that good?
Well, this is what, then we go to my three principles. It is not good because I would not want a society where people rob each other.
So that's just your personal opinion.
I think morality, everybody has their own personal opinions on morality.
Argumentative ad populum again.
No,
fallacy.
I'm just saying
you're
that's
not
what
grounding it in logic. You're
no, I'm
grounding
saying
it
I do that.
Preference.
I'm saying you do that. Everybody does that. That's what I mean. That's just by definition.
I can justify mine. You can't.
I did justify mine, though.
No. You don't realize what you're doing. You're saying the goal is the means, or is the goal is what's good. But why is it good? Because it's the goal. Well, is the goal good? Yes. Well, why is the goal good? Because it's what we want.
I didn't say the goal is good. I was saying, by definition, morality is about behavior, just like math is about numbers.
And you said by definition morality is about behavior? Who said that?
Me.
Okay.
You know, for example, I could say math is all about numbers, and you could say, like, why is that? Why does math have to be about numbers? I think it should be about letters. What about algebra? I think math should be about letters, not numbers. And it's like, okay. Just by definition, math is about numbers. Morality is about behavior.
So then, you say morality is about behavior. Is that a universal truth?
What else could it be about if it's not about behavior?
I'm asking you, is it a universal truth?
No, I think it's just by definition. I mean, if you look in the dictionary, I think that's what it's about.
So you just say by definition.
Yes.
That's just what it is because you say so.
I think that's what everybody agrees to. By definition, just like math is about numbers, morality is about behavior.
Morality is about behavior.
Mm-hmm.
Is it about intention?
Yes, because intention's tied to behavior.
See, if I slap you in the face, we're sitting there, is it good or is it bad that I did that? Morally good or morally bad if I slap you?
I think it's bad.
What if it's to save you from that really venomous bee that was on your cheek?
Mm-hmm, that's good.
That's good. Maybe. So it's not the behavior, is it?
Well, that's the subjective part. I mean,
no, it's the motive. It's the non-behavior issue. The exact behavior of slapping you upside the head, which I wouldn't do unless it was a good reason, a morally good reason, okay, isn't the issue. It's the motivation, which is not the behavior. I just showed you that your system is wrong.
I don't think so.
I did.
Because I mean, it's the same old question about stabbing somebody. Should you stab somebody? No. Well, what if I'm doing surgery? Oh, okay, yeah. I mean, it's like... It's
Behavior is an action.
Like I said, we're talking about what makes a better society. If people go around stabbing each other, what's the reason? If they're going around stabbing each other because they want to prove how cool they are or how strong they are, that's going to be a bad society. If they're going around stabbing each other to do surgery on each other to prolong their lives, that's a good thing.
See?
You know, as long as everybody...
So the motivation is the issue, not the behavior. You just refuted yourself.
No, I think motivation is part of the analysis. It's part of the calculation.
You didn't say that. You said behavior is what determines what's good and bad. I showed you that's not true. You even demonstrated it as not being true. What you should do now is say, you know what? I think you got a good point there. Really, it's an issue of behavior. And I just contradicted myself. It's an issue of motivation or motive, not just behavior.
I don't know. Let's pick another example and look at it. You want to do that?
Sure.
Or we can talk about this a little bit more. Let me give a little bit more input here. Another way I look at it is, for example, like I said, behavior, morality is about behavior, and I kind of see it as a map. Like, let's say, for example, in a Google car, you can say, drive me from point A to point B. Is there an absolute best point A to point B map? No, it might depend on the traffic. It might depend on roadblocks. It might depend on all kinds of things. And so it'll say, based on all this, this is the best path at the moment. And that's exactly with morality. You want to get to a good society. Is there an absolute best way to get to that society? No, it depends on the circumstances.
Let me ask you a question.
And it has nothing whatsoever to do with God. God doesn't even come into the play. It's like, what is good about society? Don't tell me about what you think God said. It's totally irrelevant.
No, you're begging the question. You're assuming the goal is the right one to begin with. That's all you're doing. You're just assuming a position.
But I think even the dictionary agrees. I mean, if you look up in the dictionary, it just defines it. It's just by definition.
Okay. You're just assuming that what you're aiming for is the right goal to begin with. That's all you're doing. So let me ask you a question. Mm-hmm. Is your view of the basis of morality the morally right view?
It doesn't seem like morals apply to that question.
We're talking about what's right and wrong.
Yeah, but see, in morals, philosophy, I mean, there's moral philosophy where people debate philosophy. What's the best kind of philosophy to have? It's an intellectual argument. I don't think it's a moral argument. I don't think it's a moral argument to define which has the best morality or system. I think it's an intellectual argument.
We're discussing morality. That's mm-hmm. what we're discussing. Mm-hmm. Now you're trying to get away from that. I asked if your view on the basis of morality is the morally right one to have. Is it something that only you have, or is it something everybody else ought to have? Ought necessitates morality.
Well, I think they ought to have it because I think it's the best that's out there, but I'm willing to learn if somebody wants to share some other ideas.
Well, do you think, and I'm going to be careful how I say this, but I mean this academically, do you think that's arrogant of you to say that? That what your personal view is what others ought to believe in?
No, because I think everybody should do the best, and as far as I know, mine's the best, but I'm willing to change if somebody has something better.
Well, what's better is the glory of God, but that's another issue. See, what you're saying is that if society does well, which is what you have to define a certain way, then that's what's good. But I keep asking you and other atheists who do the same thing as you, why is that the right standard? Why is it the right standard? Why is reducing harm the right standard? When I asked this of Dan Barker when I debated him, he doesn't have an answer. Except to say, it's what people want. Oh, so what people want is what's right?
Okay, so let me summarize with this and then let you summarize your counterpoint, okay? So
sure.
I said morality is about behavior, and then the question is what's good and bad behavior, and good behavior leads to flourishing and bad behavior hurts. And so we would try to maximize the good behavior to have a better society and everybody living with love, joy, and peace and all that. So now how would you summarize your position? What is morality all about and how do you get there?
Well, what I'm saying is that something to be ontologically good or bad has to be rooted in a moral lawgiver. You can't say something is right or is wrong from a subjective atheistic perspective, because you cannot assert any transcendental value, moral value to an action in an atheistic world. If you're going to say something is morally right or wrong by nature, you're saying it's universally right or wrong by nature. You can only have that if there's a universal transcendent moral lawgiver.
Well, but what if the moral lawgiver never said anything about it? For example, in Oregon we have legalized marijuana. Is that immoral to smoke dope?
The Bible says in Romans 13 to follow the laws of the land, but it also says to avoid sorcery. The word for sorcery in the Greek is pharmakia. It says to avoid these kind of things, but it also says herbs are given to us for our healing. I have no problem with someone using marijuana for a healing reason if it's a medically applied thing. I have a problem with people wanting to alter their brain chemistry because they think it feels good. It's the same thing with alcohol. They should not be mastered by a chemical. They should master it.
But didn't Jesus turn water into wine at a wedding just so people could feel good? Isn't that why they drank it?
No, he didn't do it just so they could feel good. I don't know what Bible you've read.
Well, I
but he did it
partying.
Because being made under the law, Galatians 4:4, he was obligated to obey his mother and his father, Exodus 20. His mother said, "Can you do something about this?" He said, "Woman, what have I to do with you? My time has not yet come." But because he was under the law, he then obeyed his mother and he helped out at the party.
And they said it was the best wine, too. So
yeah, he makes good stuff. And Jesus drank alcohol.
I think they were having a good party. I mean,
yes, no problem. Jesus was accused of being a wine bibber and a drunkard and a glutton because he hung out with those kind of people. Look, Jesus is not the blonde-haired, blue-eyed Caucasian surfer dude dressed in a woman's nightgown that's often portrayed in Christian churches.
Do you think Jesus would drink wine at
yes.
the party?
Yes.
Do you think he'd get tipsy and...
No. No, because the Bible says don't get drunk and be mastered by it. However, it does say, if I remember correctly, I hope this is the right verse, Proverbs 30, verse 6 or 30, mm-hmm. verse 7, give strong drink to the man who is perishing. And wine is considered a medicinal use.
Well, let me ask you, how about another one? How about birth control? Like the Catholics say that taking the pill is abortion, basically.
Well, I'm not an expert on that, so I can't comment about if it is abortive. It's abortive, you shouldn't do it. But I have no problem with birth control. And here's a real reason why. This is no joke. My wife has a very, very, very rare disease called SMADS 3. This is all verified, documented, doctors and everything. And when she was pregnant, our last baby, she had a lot of heart palpitations. We had to go to emergency complications. So I got fixed after our last child. Because potentially the next pregnancy could kill her as she was getting older, it was getting worse. No problem there.
What did God say about it, though?
He doesn't.
Well, I thought but he's the one who says what's morally right and wrong.
No, he doesn't say that you can't have a vasectomy, for example, or that you can't practice birth control. There are times when birth control is appropriate. What if my wife and I were 25 years old, we're married, we're captured by the bad guys, or we're in a concentration camp? Should we go, hey, let's have babies?
But if morality comes from God, his declaration, how do you know what's morally right if he never said anything about it?
We take what he has revealed, and we apply it as best we can to the various circumstances.
Okay, so you try to extrapolate from what he did say.
Yes, nothing wrong with that. He doesn't give every single circumstance.
So.
Do you do this on Tuesday facing west or facing north on Thursday? Which is it, Matt? You know, come on.
Well, Matt, we got through three topics, and we're at the end of our time, and we didn't have time for two, so I guess we could do our extended talk on the other two.
Sure, let's do it. Let's have fun.
So anyway, I'd like to thank you for calling in. This is the end of our regular show.
Okay.
I got 30 seconds. Would you like to summarize anything on our show today?
Yeah, let me just say that, thanks for having me on. I appreciate it. You're not an obstreperous atheist. You have differences of opinions, and that's fine. And I think we had a good conversation. And, I appreciate that. So I will look up pseudo-genes, and I think you should study more objective moral issues and what that means. But, I appreciate it. Have you on again.
Okay, and I'll try to remember to send you that link because it's a really good tutorial, and it was meant as a tutorial about the evolution evidence and DNA. So
okay.
I've watched it numerous times. It's pretty good.
Okay.
Okay. Well, thanks for calling in.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So now we can do our extended. Let's see. What time is it? Okay. We got 7:00, 7:20. Wow. 10 minutes each. Okay, how about if we try to go for 10 minutes each on these other two?
Okay, just talk. Yeah, let's go for it.
Okay, so this section is called Can One Feel the Presence of God? One of the things on here I'll note is that William Lane Craig, I'm sure you know who William Lane Craig is, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's probably one of the most popular Christian debaters. I'll paraphrase, and you can believe me or not if he said this, but from what I understand, he basically said that for himself personally, you know, he feels the presence of God, and he cannot put this forward as a evidence for the existence of God in a debate, but this is what he knows personally. I mean, personally, this is a strong evidence. And myself, I mean, I would say when somebody says they feel the presence of God, I think I know exactly what they're talking about. I felt like I was led by God. I felt like I prayed to God. I even talked to Mormons at one point, and they said to pray to God about the Book of Mormon, and you'll get a burning in the bosom if it's true. And I did that, and I actually got the burning in the bosom, but I was a Mormon for about 5 seconds because I realized it's, you know, I know the nonsense about the Mormon religion. There's no way it could be true. So I had a little conversation in my head about that for about 10 seconds. So I was a Mormon for about 10 seconds, actually. But anyway, I just have to conclude because I believe that the evidence points to a naturalistic worldview. I don't believe in the supernatural, and therefore I have to conclude that it's a delusion. So that's my viewpoint on it.
Okay.
So do you feel like that's a good argument for the existence of God, maybe even just personally, or...
Well, let me tell you, it's so subjective. I would not bring it up in a debate. As here's evidence. It's not evidence. It's subjective. It's experiential. But let me tell you this, okay? I buried a son. I've had to carry the body of my child to the grave. Now, may it never happen to you or any of the listeners.
It has happened to me also.
Oh man, I'm sorry. Mm. I'm really sorry to hear that. I'm dead serious, man. Okay, then you understand.
Mm-hmm.
It's hell, okay? It's just hell. That's there's no other word for it. Well, you can imagine, you don't have to imagine, weeping, the intensity of that weeping. All right, let's leave it at that.
Mm-hmm.
I've done it, okay. Well, you're the only one I've known who's, okay, but at any rate, so I'm not trying to make it feel bad, but when I was 17, I was an agnostic. I wanted to be a marine biologist. I'm one of the smart guys in our high school. I took all the advanced classes. They even created a class in physics and asked 30 of the students out of 2,000, would you be in the class if we did it? It'll be very difficult. I said, sign me up. I love that stuff. Mm-hmm. I wanted to be a marine biologist, seriously. I even met Jacques Cousteau, okay? Now, I'll skip a lot of details. I was tricked into walking up front of the church, and I went through what's called Pascal's Wager, not knowing that's what it was. I decided to give Jesus a chance. I decided to be sincere in a prayer. Might as well give it a chance. I'm skipping some details, but all I can tell you is the Holy only look through my tear-filled eyes at the carpet. I knew I was in the presence of holiness. Then Jesus was next to me. I don't know how I knew. I couldn't see him. I could not touch him. I just knew he was there. I was aware of his presence. I was aware of who he was. I was aware of his attention. I continued to weep with such profound force, aware of who he was and what he was and his holiness. And then all I can tell you is he moved into me, and I was changed. Now, I'm skipping a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That's when I was 17. I'm 59. I've calmed down quite a bit since then. Something miraculous did happen. I was converted from an agnostic evolutionist who's involved in the occult to a hardcore born-again Christian within seconds. Now, that's really what happened. If it happened to you, you'd be a Christian like me. Because no other possibility.
I've had similar things.
No, you haven't.
I remember many years ago I did my first TV show, and... after that show, I couldn't even sleep. I was like on super adrenaline. I just felt, the way I would describe it is that my spirit was just so supercharged by God. I felt really close to God.
Not the same thing.
There was a time where I went forward to churches a lot because I wanted to get, you know, speaking in tongues. And I went church after church and nothing ever happened. And there's this one time where I felt this force field and actually went down and I felt that force field some other time in a different church. I've felt this incredible love, like this is only the love of God. I mean, I've felt convinced that I felt a relationship with God.
Well, all I can tell you is, if you had my experience, you would never be able to turn your back on it. That's how profound it was. Mm-hmm. I've talked to people who've had similar experiences to what you've described, feeling a presence, feeling this, feeling that.
Mm-hmm. Well, see, for me, though, I understand 100%, I think, what you're saying about the experience, and I feel the same way. The only reason why I have to dismiss it is because of evidence. And it's the same thing about the Mormon feeling. I prayed about the Book of Mormon, and I got a feeling. And even though the feeling is real, I have to say this cannot be real, because we both know how goofy Mormonism is, how crazy
it
is.
Yeah, it's goofy.
We both know Joseph Smith is a false prophet. There's no way the Book of Mormon is a true book of God.
You got that right.
But I prayed about it, and I got a feeling.
Did you pray to see if it was not true?
No, I prayed as the Mormons asked me to pray, to pray that God would give you a burning in the bosom if it's true.
Yeah, Moroni 10:34 in the Book of Mormon says to pray to see if it's not true.
Well, anyway, I prayed to see if it was true, and I got a feeling. And so basically, it's a deception. It has to be a deception. I mean, it's basically the mind.
It was a deception.
What's that?
You're right. It was a deception.
Mm-hmm. But it was a real feeling.
Yeah. Feelings can be deceptive. That's why I said I don't use my testimony, so to speak, in a debate. Mm-hmm. You asked me about that and about experience. I gave it to you.
Right. I mean, I talked to this one professor, Christian professor, and he said that he knows God is real just like he knows his spouse is real, because he has a relationship with God like he has with his spouse. And I was thinking, no, that's not the same at all, because you can see your spouse. So it's you can't have that kind of argument.
Well, you know, this is the problem with subjective experiences. I don't present them as evidence. People ask me, why are you a Christian? That's what I tell them. This is why I'm a Christian. Mm-hmm. This is what God did to me. Mm-hmm. You can dismiss it, and you'll have to face him on the day of judgment and talk to him about it.
Well, you know, the other thing I think about, too, is like a mirage in the desert. If you can really see a mirage. You can really see a lake, but it's not mm-hmm. there. It's fake.
Yeah.
And so even though it's there, you can see it. I don't know. Maybe you can even see it on a video camera. I don't know.
It's imaginary, just like atheism.
Well, atheism is not seeing something that's...
Well, what is atheism?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, I mean, I believe that the Bible God can be falsified. That's why I wrote the book on it. I'm in my booklet on it.
Well, I don't believe it can, but what's atheism?
My kind of atheism is that I believe God does not exist.
Okay, so you're a strong atheist.
Yes.
Okay. So your particular kind is that you believe he doesn't exist. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Right.
All right. So is your belief true or is it not true?
I think it's true.
You don't know if it's true for sure. You just believe
right.
it is.
We don't know anything for sure, but I would say
I think
it's
true. You
sure
you don't know anything for sure?
Am I sure I don't know anything for sure?
You said we don't know anything for sure. You sure about that? It's a self-refuting statement, see? It's a quick logic.
Am I sure about that? I think good question. Am I sure about that? I think I'm sure about that.
It's like saying we can't be absolutely sure about anything.
I think I am sure that I am not sure about everything.
Then you're not sure about the statement you made, which
exactly.
is self-refuting.
Yes, I'm not sure about that statement either. I'm pretty solid on it, but I'm not sure about it.
Okay, so in other words, it's your opinion that maybe you could be wrong about a lot of things, including your atheism.
Yeah, I mean, don't you agree that you could be wrong about everything you know?
No, not everything.
Not everything?
No.
Well, what about the old argument? I mean, this could be the Matrix, or you could be dreaming right now.
I'm not dreaming.
But you could be.
No.
Haven't you ever had a dream that everything seems perfectly normal, but then when you wake up and you go, oh my gosh, that was kind of goofy, but when I was in the dream, everything seemed perfectly fine and logical.
Yeah. You know what solipsism is?
Mm-hmm. It's kind of the same thing where you just think what you see is everything's about you.
Yeah. I'm not dreaming because there are certain laws of logic and the transcendental nature of things and transcendentals themselves, which are not the product of my imaginary mind. I cannot be dreaming because then they would not have their absolute quality and values.
But you can boil it all down to everything seems reasonable to you now, but like in a dream, everything seems reasonable too. But
not everything seems reasonable. Atheism doesn't seem reasonable to me.
No, I mean, your worldview seems reasonable. Logic seems reasonable, everything. But maybe once you wake up, you'll say, oh, my gosh, I had a goofy dream.
Yeah, but you're just saying, what if maybe hypothetically that you don't know about? This is what atheists do. I mean, not trying to be disrespectful to you, but this is the kind of evidence that they give me. The arguments they give me, they're not very solid arguments.
No, I don't believe I'm dreaming right now. Okay. I'm just saying there's a possibility. I don't think it's very significant or anything.
There's logical problems with that. How do you believe Christianity can be falsified, or the Christian God? I'm curious about that one. Seriously.
But we have 9 minutes. We're supposed to do one more topic.
Oh, sorry about that. Okay. Your show.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Well, if you're interested, we can do another show sometime,
sure,
too, and we can go over that. I'd love to go over that with you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so let's go on to the next topic. Do you want to summarize anything on that one quick?
Nah. Oh, okay. I will. You're wrong, I'm right. Okay, next.
Okay, I agree. You're wrong, I'm right.
Okay, there we go.
Okay. So the last one is, why is there something rather than nothing?
Because God created it.
Who created God?
Nobody.
So God was just, I mean, I feel sorry for God because he's like, you know, I don't know where I came from.
He didn't come from anywhere. It's a wrong question.
So God just happened to look around and he always saw himself existing.
Not happen to look around, because if he always saw himself existing, there wouldn't be a point where he happened to look around to see if that were the case.
Well, you know, God tries to, I think there's kind of a comedy routine in here where God tries to figure out, like, okay, I'm really going to figure it out this time. Where was I? I'm going to trace this all back. Where was I the day before that? Okay, I got that. Where was I the day before that? Dang it. I'm going back eternally. I can't find my beginning. I don't know how I got here.
Do you know, he does know how he got here. He's eternal. There is no I got here, which means
so he's like,
that there was a time when he wasn't there, which is not what the Christian theology teaches.
So he's like a lucky guy. He's like, how lucky,
lucky
am I?
Lucky guy?
Yeah, I'm a lucky guy. Oh, okay. I found myself eternally existing. I have no idea how I got to be eternally
how
existing.
How do you know he doesn't know how he's eternally existing?
Because he didn't make himself. He has no idea how he got there.
How do you know he doesn't have any idea about that?
How would he? He didn't make himself.
But you don't know? You're speaking for God now. He wouldn't know about this. How do you know?
Because he didn't create himself.
You're right. Good. I'm glad you agree. He didn't create himself. Psalm 90, verse 2.
So how would he know?
He told us. That's how we know. He
no,
told
no,
us. He
no. How would he himself know?
I don't know how he would know. I don't have the privilege into the mind and thinking of God. Do you know what an actual infinite is versus a potential infinite?
I think so.
An actual infinite. For example, we take a yardstick. How many? 2 points. A yard, you know, a foot. Doesn't matter. How many points are on that line? An infinite number.
No, actually, there's with Planck distance, there's an actual finite number, isn't there?
They go to 10 to the 40th. A point is not a dimension, it's a location.
No, but I mean, there's a Planck time and a Planck length, and the Planck length is the smallest possible.
Right. So a point has no dimensionality, therefore it has no length.
No, not a point. I'm just saying there is an actual length. It's a Planck length.
I got you.
It's
but we're
not
not talking
point.
About that. We're
it's
talking about
point.
Points.
What?
We're talking about points, not lengths. A point is a location.
No, I thought you said if you have 2 points, A and B, and you divide it up, how many divisions can you get? Is it infinite?
How many points are on a line? There's an infinite number.
Okay. That's different than asking if you can divide it up, right?
No. And if you take half that line, how many points are on that line? An infinite number.
Yeah, points, because points don't have any dimension.
That's what I was saying. So how can half of the line be an infinite number that's equal to the whole of the line? This is a problem. It's a paradox, and it tries to demonstrate that there are no such things as actual infinites. It's like saying a set of dominoes are falling. I use this in my debate against Eddie Tabosh here in Boise State about 5 years ago. An infinite number of dominoes are falling. A line is infinitely long, left and right. We're standing there, we hear as the dominoes go by. We get in our super fast spaceship, and we go down to try and find the beginning. Well, because it's infinitely long, we're never going to find it.
Mm-hmm.
But that means there's no first domino.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which means there's no second, no third, no fourth, no fifth.
Right.
There's no sequence that could ever be started.
Right.
This is a problem that we have when we look at things from our perspective.
Right.
What you're doing is you're saying, well, how did God have a beginning? Now you're saying, where's the first domino in an infinitely long thing? There can't be one.
Right. And that's what I'm saying. The poor guy, you know, God, that poor fella,
come on now.
He stays up at night trying to think, how did I come?
Come on.
Where did I come from? I don't know. I don't know where I came from. I just, every time I look around, I'm always there. Okay. I don't even know how I came to be here. I don't know why it's me instead of Charlie. I
now you're
these
being
other
demeaning
things.
And insulting.
How? No, seriously, he doesn't
know.
No,
you're saying poor God, he stays up at night not knowing what's going on?
Yeah, the poor fella, I mean, okay. I know where I came from,
right.
But
okay.
This poor fella doesn't know where he came from.
Well, if you're going to demean the conversation to that level, well, then we're not going to have a conversation.
Okay, I just kind of think there's a comedy routine in there somewhere.
Trust me, maybe there's not. Maybe in the future. Without misrepresenting what it is the Christian theological position is.
Well, it's just like God's the lucky one who found himself eternally existing. It could have been anybody. It could have been you, but it was God. It was Yahweh who found himself eternally existing.
It could not have been me because he created me. By definition, mm-hmm. It could not have been me.
So, I mean, somehow... And then that's another strange thing. I mean, there's three of them, though, somehow, too?
Wait a minute. We're talking about God's creation. Why is there something rather than nothing? Not what the doctrine of the Trinity is. Why is there something rather than nothing? Because we exist because God created us to exist. You can't explain how things came into... Let me ask you a question. Do you know what a disjunctive syllogism is?
I know what a syllogism is. I'm not sure what a disjunctive one is.
Okay. A disjunctive syllogism says that when you only have two possibilities to account for something and one is negated, the other is validated.
Okay, I agree with you.
So we have, for example, God and not God.
Sure.
So if one of those is negated as a possible explanation for something, the other one must be valid because you can't negate both.
I could agree with that.
Disjunctive syllogism. Mm-hmm. So we have a personal cause of the universe or an impersonal cause of the universe.
Okay.
There's no other options.
Okay.
An impersonal cause of the universe would have to possess what's called the necessary sufficient conditions. In other words, all the parts necessary to bring creation into existence, bring the universe into existence.
Okay.
But not only that, it had to be sufficiently powerful, let's just say. Uh-huh. But the problem is that if it's necessary and sufficient and it possesses it, it'll possess it by nature.
Sure.
For however long it exists.
Okay.
But if it existed before the universe, we can go back to an infinite regression of what caused that, and we have the infinite regression problem, which you already discussed.
Right.
So functionally, we can just say, well, what brought into existence the universe? This thing, this substance, whatever it was.
Right.
But if it was that way, it would have to possess its nature eternally. It would have to have already been. It couldn't have come into existence. Then you've got the problem of an infinite regression.
Okay.
But if it possessed these things naturally, and the necessary sufficient conditions, then the result would have been automatic. It would have created a universe an infinitely long time ago. But the universe is not infinitely old.
Wait a second, though. I mean, there could be the creation of the Big Bang, which...
Beginning?
Wait, and physicists don't agree that was the beginning of time, but let's say, for example, that's the beginning of time, so there was something outside of that created it. But it could still be a multiverse or something.
Well, then where do the multiverses come from? And this is something that people are just theorizing that they don't know about.
Of course, yeah, it's all theory. Nobody knows anything. Nobody knows the answer.
But we do know, logically, that whatever brought the universe into existence had to precede it and had to have the ability to do that. It had to have the necessary sufficient conditions.
Right, I agree.
But if it's impersonal, it had to have those conditions eternally. If it had it eternally, it would have brought it into existence. But the universe is not infinitely old. Mm. Therefore, the impersonal cause of the universe cannot work. And the other view has to be validated. There's a personal cause of the universe.
It seems like you're making a jump there to a personal being.
It's a disjunctive syllogism, which you agreed with.
I think something got lost in the translation there.
Well, we're about out of time. I'm trying to get it out quickly here. What do you want? We can discuss it slowly at a later time.
Yeah, we only got 40 seconds now. So.
See? Okay.
Okay, so I'll let you summarize, and then we're going to have to say goodbye on this one.
Okay. Real simple. An impersonal cause of the universe cannot work logically. The only other option is a personal cause, because you can't have an impersonal cause of the universe be in place. I can explain it again another time when we have more time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, one thing I've learned from this show with you is that there's no way we can do these topics. I was just trying to hope to get some kind of, I don't know, it's like we're not even scratching the surface on 10 minutes on these subjects.
That's right. So. I do this a lot, so it takes time.
Okay, well, I appreciate the call and all that, so thanks for participating.
Sure, no problem, man. Give me a call again, we'll do it again, okay?
Okay, sounds like fun. All right, take care.
Thanks.
Goodbye. Okay.